morning, sir. I just have a simple question. Knowing the Indian mindset as we go in our country, the Mandal Commission in 1980s was also meant to alleviate social poverty. And we all know where the country stands today, devastated demographically with the reservation issue. How can we guarantee ourselves that this also does not become a tool in the hands of subsequent governments and become a potential disaster in the future?
Should I answer questions as they come, or look, an easy answer to your question would have been that if anything, UBI in spirit is the antithesis of a job reservation by caste kind of policy, because it's a universal policy that applies to everybody independent of any social. That would have been an easy answer to give. And I stand by that. That is part of the answer, that this is different, because it's like, you know, nobody can dispute that having better infrastructure is good, and certain governments that have invested more in infrastructure deserve that praise because it's of use to everybody, as opposed to things that are targeted to specific groups. That's where always the division of the pie versus, you know, something that to help. But where you're right, though, and there I don't have any, so that would have been kind of an easy answer to give. But a more nuanced answer to give, if I really take your question in the right spirit, every government program, and this is something that as somebody like many other economists who started fairly from the left of center and then got education in mainstream economics, in my case that took me to Chicago, every government program that's meant to solve a problem also creates a problem of its own. First of all, it creates a bureaucracy that has to enforce it, and then it creates jobs that could never be taken away, and then it becomes a permanent thing that even though in some ways the cause has gone away, you cannot get rid of that, right? So therefore, in that spirit, I agree, whether it's certain aspects of our public sector system, certain aspects of a system of how banks work, where, you know, the loan default and the NPA problem that we are discussing. So I would say absolutely the Mandal Commission particular policy that you're referring is one in a whole list of things where you could argue that it essentially, one is the question, is it universal or is it specific to, you know, certain social groups, as opposed to poverty is an economic condition that could affect any of us, right? And secondly, are there ways we should essentially reevaluate government policies and have a way of taking them out when they're not so relevant? And there are very few episodes in India other than 91 and certain cases where maybe because of external pressures or internal pressures, we tried to do that. So on that, I would say what you're saying gives us grounds for concern, and I would not shrug it off.
Right.
Professor, just a quick question here. Given that linkages that, I mean, you're in your hybrid model, you talked about linking it to UBI to NAREGA kind of a thing. It's an, I would be tempted to ask, have you done any calculation, like in terms of ballpark, linking to Indian GDP, how it will work out? The numbers, ballpark numbers.
Sure, that's a great question. And in some ways, this is one case where you have caught me a bit unprepared, because I'm actually working on it for a piece I'm writing, and I have not, but I can give you the rough percentages here, because we already saw, if we go back to the earlier NAREGA numbers, it's about 0.39% of GDP as it currently stands, right? So even with the existing budget, say a 1% of GDP flat fee with that NAREGA amount, that would give you a ballpark of what I would say without thinking through, because once you have the both, not everybody will, you know, essentially use the NAREGA. Maybe some of them will be happy with the UBI. So therefore, this answer is not quite a rigorous answer, but at least that would be a ballpark answer to that. But it's a great question, and it is something I my spreadsheet I'm working on right now.
Okay, there's a question.
Yeah, hello, my name is Gadget Maz. I'm a branding consultant, and thanks for, you know, explaining the symptom versus curing the disease. My question is about developed countries and underdeveloped countries. So if we are all shareholders, you know, where the country gives me a dividend because it's earning, then I can afford to have a, you know, a distribution of income. But if I'm borrowing from the World Bank as an underdeveloped country like India, on what basis can I think of giving a guaranteed income to somebody? Because it's borrowed money. It's not money that I'm earning.
That's a great question. I would say, and I am not just, you know, I mean, it is a very serious question. I think in the way I frame it, in fact, I was asked a really good question in yesterday when I was interacting with some members of the local press. One of them asked me that, look, if you think about selling a policy as opposed to devising it, anti-poverty policies are political sellers. I mean, there's not a problem as to what you're trying to do, that look, this is for the garibo ke liye, and that's clearly appeals to people's moral senses as well as political senses. Where universal policies are, in some ways, what is the best way you're going to sell it, okay? And the thing that you said about citizens' dividend, to me, that seems to be the most natural way to, you know, in some ways, provide a justification for it, that as much as if you had ancestral property, or if you dwell in a forest, which if essentially, you know, where you have depended on the livelihood, and that forest is somehow converted to some other use, I think, again, I cannot assume everybody would agree to it, but most people would agree that stakeholders should have some share of anything that is sort of collectively owned. So if you think from the point of view of a country, natural resources are something that you could argue that logically belong to the people. There's no sense in which, you know, if somebody comes up with a better smartphone, somebody comes up with a better formula for something, I'm willing to be quite, favorable to be the idea that let's not tax or expropriate that to the extent that it harms innovation and growth. Because that's something your human capital is doing it, or if you have saved and accumulated a lot, suddenly expropriating that would undermine savings incentives and so on. So I'm willing to go with that. But natural resources, it's hard to come up with that idea. So on that, I largely agree that it would have to be, and therefore there are two ways to think about it. You know, one is exactly linking it to some explicit natural resource and revenue from it and really coming, which is the Alaska Permanent Fund, that you're basically selling oil, this is what is collectively owned, and that budget item is therefore distributed as a dividend. That would be one model. The other idea would be related to the growth dividend that I've been talking about. So some of my professional colleagues like Debraj Ray and Kale Moen have proposed this idea of a universal basic share, where essentially it's a bit like what I was saying, that let's think of 1% of GDP or something, right? As opposed to a specific sum, because that's a way you can think about that when the economy is growing or things are going well, you can afford to give out more. When it's not doing so well, you can give less. So the only last thing that I would correct, though, I don't have the number at the top of my head, but India is not so dependent on World Bank loans as it used to be. So, and most of the calculations, in fact, all the calculations here are based on tax revenue that is being raised in India, right? So therefore, otherwise, I would agree that it would be almost like, you know, really perverse to have to depend on others for a loan or a grant. And then, you know, even there, if it's a grant, you could make the case that, look, if it's a grant, that may be a best way to, you know, reach the final beneficiaries, but surely not for a loan. Yeah.
Just a thought sort of on this whole business of sort of hybrids, perhaps. It struck me while you were speaking. I mean, couldn't we have a sort of this whole question of targeted versus universal, that for the bottom two quartiles in districts, the bottom two quartile districts in developmental terms, you come up with something like UBI, which is universal. But for the top two quartiles, where there is already a certain certain level of development, you then sort of focus in a much more targeted way. I mean, this is really looking at it in a spatial and geographical sense, rather than sort of, you know, so it's a hybrid in that sense.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And in a way, Arvind Subramaniam, in his, that I think chapter 16 of the 2016-17 economic survey, when he discusses universal basic income, he too, when he faces the math, the arithmetic of, you know, what you can afford, he thinks of these, some of these, you know, one thing is like, look, you take indicators about how much wealth people own and then exclude them. So if somebody owns a car, you don't get the UBI, something like that. And he also mentioned the possibility of doing it geographically. I think it's a good idea, and if anything, the current proposal that I discussed and critiqued, the minimum income guarantee, they are discussing it to start it experimentally in some of the poorer districts. So therefore, on that way, it's more related to what you're saying. My only hesitation here would be, if it's a matter of rolling it out and starting with the poorest areas, then I'm all for it. But otherwise, the Chicago school economist in me, which coincides with somebody who's more coming from the, you know, left of center of trying to, you know, making poverty alleviation to be one of the key sort of, you know, goals of economic justice, you're going to create sort of distort the migration pattern in a way that in a transition economy like that, I would want to think very hard about sort of, you know, signing up for it right away. So I would say that is one of the margins that come, you know, essentially if you say, look, to stay in, Purulia in West Bengal, I'm from West Bengal, so that's a relatively poor district, then you get this, but the moment you move to, say, Medinipur or some other district, you lose it. I would worry about that, both the logistical side of it and the kind of incentives it creates. But I'm not dismissing it. I mean, in the end, the name of the game is thinking of ways in which you can make the fiscal math more palatable without creating new inefficiencies or targeting problems. I think that would be the summary.
Could someone check the second mic, please? I think it's not working.
Little curious to look at the case of China. I think that's the largest case study in history of poverty alleviation. So how have they handled the whole issue in terms of income generation? Also a little interested in Brazilian case where they have this targeted intervention for, what is the feasibility or what is the impact of the Brazilian case study, if you can speak on that.
Sure.
Thank you so much.
Okay, no, I think these are all, as I said, that in some ways, the conditional cash transfer versus unconditional cash transfer, when I referred to that, Brazil's Bolsa Familia and Mexico's what used to be called Progressa, which has now been renamed as Oportunidades, essentially are conditional transfers where families are monitored for certain health and education status of their children, right? And so long as they're enrolled in school and they have taken their immunizations, etc., right, they're going to get the money. I think in the end, it would depend on your assessment about the, you know, so clearly the broad study that I know by Sarah Baird of the World Bank, it's a meta study that looks at various countries about conditional versus unconditional. If you just search by Sarah Baird, you should be able to find that kind of meta study. In general, unconditional transfers essentially are more efficient in terms of not having an entire bureaucracy having to go monitor and so on. But conditional cash transfers are good at what they aim to do. So in other words, the kind of the pro and con of that would be, with unconditional cash transfer, I just need to make sure that the money reaches you. After that, I don't have to send somebody to go check whether your kids are in school or not, right? So that's the advantage of unconditional cash transfers. But clearly, because conditional cash transfers do that, now, of course, you can think of environments where it will be dysfunctional, and there are parts of India where you can see how it will be undermined by the actual implementation process. But in Brazil and Mexico, I think they have done reasonably good job implementing it subject to the resource costs, and indeed it has led to better school and health outcomes. Okay, so therefore, going back to what I was saying, that look, I personally, I don't like, and this is ironic, but I actually do not like things that incentivize or subsidize too much. But that's my philosophical take on things, whether in terms of, but having said that, if on balance this is going to work well in India, I'm not certainly going to throw any ideological objection. So that is an experimental thing. About China though, I have to guard against, because it's such a, you know, comparing India and China is a matter of maybe a 1 year whole, you know, lecture series in which I am not the most biggest expert to talk about that. It's such a deep and big and, you know, broad issue. But I have this mixed feeling about the Chinese growth model, which is often, you know, posed as something very enviable. It is absolutely true that since 91, right, I mean, when India liberalized, and since the late 70s, when China adopted the household responsibility system under Deng Xiaoping, when, you know, they were still reeling from the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution, etc., India and China have together contributed to the large number of, I would never underestimate India's contribution to those numbers too. And I'm not being kind of, you know, any, you know, sort of nationalistic in a narrow sense. I'm just literally doing the accounting here, because China is, after all, it is larger than India, and China has done an excellent job. But India's contribution to that poverty alleviation is also there. But I would say the following, and this may be perhaps the most controversial thing I would be saying this evening, and maybe you're all being very polite, and I have already said many controversial things that you have not given me any hard time on. Look, in China, Great Leap Forward famine, 30 million people died. So I like the Chinese model. There's a lot to learn from the Chinese model. But I do not think that in some ways we should, in a way, I mean, the Indian model may be shaky, it has been rickety, it has plagued with problems, and we are an argumentative and self-critical nation, and that's good, right? But I do think that if you really think about a serious development model, right, the Chinese model, the Great Leap Forward famine, right, that actually by objective standards, and now more and more data are becoming available and people are doing just changes in stunting, etc., those kind of more subtle approaches. So what I would try to say is that, look, I wouldn't recommend that model, but again, that is my personal ideological or philosophical bias, because I'm fundamentally against the state taking an extremely intrusive approach to the development process. But somebody else could well say that, look, it's true that that happened, but if you think about those who lived and survived, they have done better than their counterparts in India. I would say that's a fair counterpoint, and that's a debate in which, you know, we have to kind of, you know, have like leave room for both having some points here. But that's why I think the Chinese model, even now, a lot of the, you know, I think in terms of just the national income statistics, right? I'm always deeply skeptical as to what to believe when China adjusts their growth rates from, I don't know, 9% to 6%, suddenly 4% to 8%. I'm vaguely, you know, it's almost like, you know, like whatever, you know, one of those carrot wheel type things that I exactly don't know what's going on. So I would say without greater transparency and in some ways less state intrusiveness, I would be more favorable to that model. Otherwise, I'm not saying we shouldn't learn, you know, we should learn from all countries and all experiences of people who have done well, right? But anyway, that perhaps was a bit more getting into the more the ideology and alternative growth paths and between India and China.
Maitreesh, are you okay with a couple of questions?
I'm enjoying it, so subject to the food attracting people or refreshments, I'm happy to continue for a bit more. Yes.
Now, this is a question with relation to our supposedly changed...
Hold your mic close.
Supposedly changed planning framework. So we have a Niti Aayog set up, which is supposed to be bottom-up rather than the planning commission, as it is commonly understood, perhaps. Now, do you think it will help in generating a good survey-based data on needs so that whether cash transfers vis-a-vis categorical equity, how do you view this as an issue in implementation?
I would say, again, I would try to sidestep the discussion about Niti Aayog and Planning Commission, because these days Niti Aayog has been in the news often for not the most salutary of reasons about, you know, data issues, about employment, etc. I would like to sidestep that discussion because it's not really related to the theme of this evening. Subject to that, I would say, yes, I think the more bottom-up approach of doing experiments and then scaling up. And some of the things that actually are reported in Subramaniam's, you know, some of the economic surveys until last year that he did, right? And my friend and co-author Karthik Muralidharan of University of California, San Diego, he's, I think he's involved with the Niti Aayog, and he's the person who has done some of these large-scale evaluations in Andhra Pradesh and so on. So I think that approach is very much appreciated. I think what would be useful, and I try to say completely neutrally, not getting into some of the data controversies and so on, is I wish their website, as well as overall as a resource, it would be much more useful to those who don't necessarily get to see the reports that are being written. So maybe a lot of the things are in the pipeline and they're cooking, and when they come out, I think that'll be very useful. So I would completely grant that, especially given my conversations with Karthik Muralidharan and the likes of him who are working with him. But on the other hand, it's not like there are that many reports that are available that we you know, can judge the Niti Aayog for this kind of activities. We still, I think, the best data sources, if you really want to look for India, any kind of data, is still the much beleaguered or much debated Reserve Bank of India database and some others. So in some ways, that's where Niti Aayog should do a better job dissemination the results of some of these more field level studies, decentralized ones.
Okay.
So, in your presentation, you made a mention that this UBI is a stopgap arrangement. You can't sacrifice long-term plan to alleviate poverty. So my question is, do we need this stopgap arrangement, and why we need it now? So secondly, sir, what kind of impact it will have on our long-term plans to alleviate poverty?
Some of the answers were already in some of the discussions, but let me just summarize it to make it related to your question. I think, as I said at the very beginning, I don't think if you take the health analogy that I gave, if you're extremely hungry, right, then having some facility and you don't have any money in your pocket, that having a facility where you can get a meal for yourself is not a substitute for you not being a state where you need these free meals every now and then. So I don't think that these are substitutes. As much as you need band-aids, you need first aid boxes, but you also need hospitals and surgeries, okay? And it's a false debate, and I really don't know what to say. I mean, we can debate the relative importance of it, but no serious welfare state or no serious development plan should have zero amounts of direct transfers or zero amount of infrastructure development, because that would help business and employment. I think we can debate, of course, how much of it. Second thing, I don't think your premise is right, though, and that's where Arvind Subramaniam's reports are so useful. These anti-poverty programs have been there since the very beginning. So, why knock up? UBI is just trying to help here. It's like the guy who's saying, look, all these other things, they're, plagued with so many problems. Let's fold out and get rid of some of them and make them simple, which is what, for example, some of the DBT type things that the current government has done, has already done. So otherwise, it's not like why now is that, in some ways, maybe our fiscal difficulties as making us force and face some of these challenges. But anti-poverty program funds allocation under it has been there since the beginning, and part of it is really, are they really useful? Okay,
one last question.
Thank you very much, Professor, for a very enlightening talk. The question is, I do travel to rural parts of the country every year, and I do interact with a lot of people in the farming sector, etc. So though we talk about MGNREGA and the good things that are being done, there's a lot of leakage. And let's say I travel in West Bengal, so you need to be a party person.
Sure, yeah.
Earlier it was red party, now it is green party. And those people are given the amount, and 30%, 40% has to be given back to whoever is given first. So these are leakages which are there in the system. Secondly, I would be very keen to know your work which you have done with regard to Bihar. Because Bihar used to be the gold standard on the other side, that of every rupee for the project, 10 paisa, if it reaches, we would say that is the bottom of the country. How is your experience in the last few years? Or
yeah, that's those are extremely relevant questions. So and cannot be ignored. So I would say that, look, I have a suspicion that even if we all agreed on UBI this evening, suppose we have the power to decide and we all voted for it, and I'm not being presumptuous at all that we will, but suppose we did, yeah? I have a feeling that in Bihar and parts of West Bengal and some other states, there will be ways in which people will then be queuing up, and politics will enter even that. So I have no doubt that in some ways, we can only come up with what policies that would work relatively better. But in the implementation of it, there is a whole cross-state difference, okay? So for example, in Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, these are often called the good, good students of like good students in a school. They are the more the kind of, the good kids who are doing things that you wish others would be following. I don't have a sort of ready answer to this question. So I, my only thing would be, and this is where I actually agree with the spirit of some of the stuff that has been done even under this administration and, started earlier, we should, this is where, you know, in some ways, that's why Milton Friedman signed up on this, right? That we actually want to minimize the involvement of both the state bureaucracy as well as the political processes for certain things, right? Otherwise, if you, you know, now, and in a way, UBI, I think of all the things we are discussing, ideally, suppose, like the Middle East, suppose we suddenly discovered oil under India that was hitherto undiscovered. Suppose that happened. It's a thought experiment. And suppose immediately our national wealth goes up because of that. So therefore, we don't have to do this really difficult calculation of 1.2 versus, you know, 0.39 kind of things, right? Okay, we have a pot of money, yeah? I would think that having the Jan Dhan accounts or, in, you know, these individual accounts, right, and having a direct transfer of that money to that bank account would be at least my preferred way of spending some of it. And again, I am being, as you can see, that I'm really trying to be thorough here and not take a either policy partisan or political partisan point here, because of course you want to spend some of this on roads and infrastructure, you want to spend some of this on health and education and all of that. So I don't, unfortunately, you know, this is where I really don't have a quick answer as to how, you know, and other than the saying that we should move to more direct and kind of universal programs, because that's where anytime how you have discretion, you are giving power to the bureaucrat and you are giving power to the political systems, because in some ways they will qualify, yes, you will get it, but you will not get it, right? And that decision of who gets it and who will not get it gives them the power, right? And then now whether it was a left supporter or now if you're a TMC supporter. On Bihar, again, I think that it's interesting that the only, I've been only involved with the Bihar because of this International Growth Center's Bihar program. And I did one field survey, extensive one, and I've been evaluating or involved with others. If anything, under the bicycle scheme of Bihar, which I actually happened to do a survey, and there is a paper in the Economic and Political Weekly that came out of it. Essentially, it's a scheme where, you know, these originally girls would, who are enrolled up to class 9 would get a bicycle, right? And then the scheme was successful, so they said that even boys will now get it, etc. That worked quite well, okay? And that was also the period I was getting interested in cash transfers in UBI. So if I look back at that paper, one of the things we asked in that survey is we asked the beneficiaries, would you have preferred cash? Okay, and let me now be a very objective answer where you show where some of our, you know, our thinking is subject to ambiguity and some amount of torment. The very poor in remote areas said, no, we like the bicycle just fine. So I wish they had said, no, yeah, let's give us cash and let's go and exercise it. That would be more suitable to the, you know, broad cash transfer UBI. But that's why the qualification I put in, that if you really don't, if giving Robinson Crusoe, who's thirsty, here's some money, buy a bottle of water, that's useless. That person said, I would much rather have a some water here, right? So I would say, again, there are cases where, you know, I mean, I'm not getting into why certain things in Bihar are perhaps more dysfunctional in terms of service delivery, etc., compared to other states. But this is, once again, my sort of general point would be some of the moves of the, current government, which I actually think have been in the right direction, and I have been critical of other directions, as some of you may know have followed, is the Jan Dhan and these kind of attempts are the right things to go about, because fundamentally you're expanding the soft infrastructure. And the more you do it and you do certain connections in which you can reach individual citizens, right, if you lay down the framework of that, right, and clearly some of this started earlier, so therefore there's not necessarily any monopoly of any particular administration over it, but no doubt that there has been some good work on that. So that aside, so this is where I like the China comment. I'm going to make tall claim, but or at least a statement of my view. I would try to have a system where government interference is as little as possible in the entire economy, subject to a clean and transparent tax system which has a significant emphasis on dealing with the problem of poverty. And the reason is, I think, for a country like India, is, given the path where it has done so much better in the last 2.5 decades than before. Just to give you an idea that even according to that number that Rangarajan provided and so on, poverty estimates are 20% to 30%, depending on which line you're taking. And what sums are we talking about? We are talking about 1600 rupees to 1800 rupees per month. Anybody who has lived in any part of India, you will know that that is really a very, very tough definition of poverty. And if you just double it, you know what percentage of Indians are below that? That's 75%. So if you just double that line, so therefore I would say it is a political necessity as well as a moral compulsion for us to, whatever is your specific ideology or political thing, that we cannot dodge this problem, because otherwise this will drag down our potential. You can convert the poor into productive individuals who contribute to the economic process, or it will be forever that part of the country or the system that will drag down. You cannot have Silicon Valley surrounded by sub-Saharan Africa. I'm not saying all of India is like that, but the more prosperous India, if you say, even if it's, let's say, 10% of the economy or 8% of the economy, it will inevitably drag it down. Okay, but that maybe was, I was more in a, I have a dream kind of, statement, but it does reflect a bit of my thinking.